दिव्या बहल, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन केमिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट एट एलजे इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग एंड टेक्नोलॉजी. द सब्जेक्ट दैट वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू दैट इज योर नैनो साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, राइट. सो इन प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी स्टडीड अबाउट कोलॉइडल मेथड ऑफ सिंथेसिस ऑफ नैनो पार्टिकल, राइट. सो इन द एंडिंग नोट ऑफ दिस टॉपिक वी कैन सी द एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस. So the most important advantage of your colloidal synthesis method is that it is a greener technique, okay? It is environmental friendly. Other than that, it is cheaper and effective, and you can get narrow size nanoparticles, okay? The range is what? About 2 to 10 nanometer, okay? But the main disadvantage is that the controlling of time and the precursor amount, okay? That is little bit critical. Right, so that was about your colloidal synthesis. So moving forward, now we will continue with the next topic, that is your emulsion. So first of all, emulsion method for the synthesis of nanoparticles, okay, that is your liquid phase synthesis method, okay. So now note down, so the ordinary emulsions, first we are going to study about simple emulsion, okay. So what are the key points? That the droplets of nanoparticles, whatever you get, okay, the average size is between 0.1 to 1 microns, okay. So that is the average size of your particles. That is the result of what? Gravitational effect, okay. And see, here what it is, that your emulsions, they are generally unstable. So after some time, because of the effect of gravity also, these two phases separate out. Okay, the liquid-liquid phase which interact together to give you an emulsion, they separate out after a certain time. Okay, now emulsions, they have a blurry appearance. Okay, then but micro-emulsions, okay, micro-emulsions, they have transparent appearance. Okay, they do not refract the light because extremely small particles, extremely small size of droplets are created in them. Okay. And they have very good properties. So because of that property, micro emulsions are used for nanoparticle production. Before starting micro emulsion, first we must know what is your emulsion. So you can see an emulsion, it is a colloidal mixture of two or more liquids that normally don't mix. Okay, best example is your water and oil. Okay, naturally oil and water, they do not mix. But when you are mixing them together and an emulsion of oil and liquid, whichever is formed, that is a category of your emulsion, okay? So the daily life examples are what? Mayonnaise, butter, milk, salad dressing, even the creams, whatever you use, okay? The cosmetic creams, those are also the emulsions, right? So it is a colloidal mixture of two or more liquids which do not mix normally, right? So now you saw that it is a colloidal mixture. We already studied about colloids. So what is the key difference between emulsion and colloids? Mainly, the key difference is that in colloid and emulsions, okay, the colloid form, it can be formed of any state of matter. Okay, it can be solid, liquid and gas. Okay, any of those state of matter can combine together and a colloid can be formed. But same is not true for emulsion. Emulsion has two liquid components which are immiscible with each other. So your emulsion is made of two liquid components which are immiscible with each other. Whereas, once again, a colloid, it is a mixture of compound, okay, and a liquid. Your compound, it can be solid also, liquid also, or gas. That it is not necessary that the phase of the two components must be same. Now let's see how emulsions are formed, right? So you have four figures, figure A, B, C and D. In figure A, you can see that I have two liquid components, okay? I have phase A and phase B which are not mixing into each other at normal conditions, okay? Now look at figure B. After rigorous mixing of these two phases A and B, I have been able to form an emulsion. How? One of my phase has been dispersed into another phase, right? Now, this is an unstable emulsion, okay? If you are keeping this emulsion for some time, the phases A and B, they will naturally separate out, okay? So, you can see in figure C how phase A is separating out from phase B. So what I have to do in order to stabilize my emulsion, I have to add an additive, that is your surfactant. Okay, you can also call it as stabilizer. So you can see in figure D that stabilizer, it forms an interface between two phases. Okay, it covers itself to one of the phase, you can see here at phase A. So this will keep them together. Okay, this will keep phases A and B together, and you can see that the phases are not separating from each other, right? Now about emulsion. So to form an emulsion, you need at least three components. Okay, first is your oil, a water, and a surfactant. Clear? So you can see here about the surfactant. Okay, it has two parts, a hydrophilic part and a lipophilic part. Okay, so what is hydrophilic? Okay, it means it has attraction towards water, hence it is soluble in water. Whereas for lipophilic part, it means it has attraction. Okay, it has attraction towards lipid, fats, oils. Okay, hence that part, it is soluble in lipids. So you can see that my surfactant, the head, it is a hydrophilic part. Okay, and the tail, the bottom part, it is a hydrophobe, right? So now let's talk about emulsion. So first of all, it is a liquid phase synthesis method, right? So when these two phases of A and B liquid, suppose two liquids, when they are together, approximately 3 to 5 into 10 raised to minus 2 Newton force per unit length. Okay, that much amount of force is required to remove the surface tension between water and oil surface. Okay, of course you can see that these two phases, whenever they are kept together, right, interfaces form between these two liquids. So in order to remove that barrier, so that these two liquids can mix with each other, you have to remove that much amount of energy, that is the surface tension. So in order to remove that energy, okay, we add surfactants. Okay, so you can read that surfactants consist of an organic molecule that have hydrophilic head and a lipophilic tail, okay, which is used to overcome this surface tension force, right? Once again, your hydrophilic part of this surfactant, it can be consisted of non-ionic or ionic groups. Okay, so we are talking about the head part, which is your hydrophilic part. Okay, so non-ionic and ionic groups can be taken as your hydrophilic head. So these groups are bonded to the hydrophobic long chain. Okay, here you can see that the hydrophilic is connected to a hydrophobic chain, okay, with covalent bonding. So we have covalent bond between hydrophilic head and hydrophobic tail. Clear? So now you can see the figure on the right hand side. It shows you, if the head is very strongly hydrophilic, it means your surfactant, it will dissolve completely into your water. Okay, if it is strongly lipophilic, okay, if it is strongly soluble into your lipids, then the surfactant, whatever you are adding, it will completely dissolve into your lipid or oils, right? So to form an emulsion, your surfactant should be such that it has a good balance between water and oil. Okay, it means your surfactant, the head, which is hydrophilic, it should be soluble in water also, and its tail, that is your hydrophobic or litho or lipophilic tail, it should be soluble in oil also. Okay, there should be a good balance between the solubility of hydrophilic head and lipophilic tail in both water and oil. Now, what are surfactants? Okay, so surfactants are those compounds that lower the surface tension between any two liquids, between a gas and a liquid, or between a liquid and solid, right? So its prime goal is to reduce the surface tension, which acts as a barrier, okay, which is the barrier because it is not allowing the two different liquids to mix together. Okay, so now you can see here that surfactants, they may act as a detergent, as a wetting agent, as an emulsifier, foaming agent, or dispersants, right? So now about the structure of your surfactants, we already saw that it has a hydrophilic head. It means the hydrophilic part, that is your head, it has attraction towards water. It always moves towards water. Other than that, its tail, okay, the tail of your surfactant, it is lipophilic in nature. It means it has attraction towards lipids or fats or oils, okay. It is also known as hydrophobic tail, okay. It means it has repulsion towards your water. So thus, about the structure of your surfactants, you can say that the head, it always moves towards water, and the tail, it moves towards fats or oils, okay. So now, the hydrophilic part, okay, it can be of four types, right? The hydrophilic part, that is your head, it can be anionic, okay, it means it has a negative charge, okay, it can be cationic also, it can be amphoteric, it means it can has both the charges, positive also and negative also, or it can be non-ionic, right? So these are the four types of charges which it can have. Once again, you can see about your surfactant that its head, it is polar hydrophilic, it means it is water loving head, okay. The bottom, that is your tail, it is non-polar hydrophobic. Polar in the sense, you might have studied in chemistry about the polar bond, okay. Generally it is formed with water molecules. So the tail, it is non-polar hydrophobic, it means lipophilic, okay, it means water hating tail, right. Now about surfactants and emulsions. So in the figure you can see that how the surfactant, it is keeping water and oil together. Okay, once you have mixed oil and water, so because of surfactants, right, because of the two parts of the surfactant, that is head and tail, head will try to attract towards water and tail will try to attract, go towards oil. And because of the mutual attraction of your head and tail towards water and oil, the two immiscible liquids, that is your water and oil, that emulsion is putting together, right? So thus in GIST I can say that because of surfactants, the surface tension between the immiscible liquid has been vanished, okay, it has been decreased. So because of that, emulsion is able to be stabilized. Once again read the point. If a very small amount of soluble surfactant is added into a water oil media and agitated, a liquid media called continuous phase in which emulsion is formed, whereas droplets of one phase is dispersed in the other phase that has surface covered with surfactant. So now in the figure you can see that my aqueous liquid, that is your continuous phase. Okay, try to imagine in a bowl of liquid you are adding some like 2 to 3 drops of oil, and when you are agitating it, a emulsion is formed by addition of a surfactant. So see, bulk quantity is what my here liquid, hence it is a continuous phase. Oil is now dispersing into liquid, so my dispersed phase is what, oil here, right? So you can see here I have to add a very little amount of surfactant into my mixture of oil and liquid. If I am agitating it, okay, if I am agitating it, the liquid media, it is your continuous phase, which is in bulk amount. If my water is in bulk amount, so that is my continuous phase, okay. And about the emulsion, the droplets of that one phase, suppose oil, if droplets of my oil, they are getting dispersed into your water, then your oil is your dispersed phase, okay. So that is about your continuous and dispersed phase. Now about types of surfactants. Once again, you have four types of surfactants we already saw. One is your anionic surfactants, okay. The head hydrophilic part is what? It is anionic. Example is what here? DOSS, okay. The commercial name is what? Pentex. Then we have cationic surfactants. The hydrophilic part, okay, the hydrophilic head is what? Cationic in nature. Example is what? CATB, cetyl trimethyl ammonium bromide. Then we have non-ionic surfactant. Okay, the hydrophilic part, the head, it is non-ionic in nature. The commercial name is what here? SPAN. Okay, it is sorbitan alkyl ester. Then we have dual group. It means anionic and cationic, both ions are present in your hydrophilic part. Example is what? Ammonium sulfobutane. Okay, so these are the types of surfactant. Now about types of emulsion. okay, even now here you have different types of emulsion based on the continuous and dispersed phase. Okay, so first is your oil in water type of emulsion. It means here the dispersed phase is what? Oil, and your continuous phase is what? Water. Oil is in water, thus it is oil in water emulsion. Next is water in oil. Here bulk quantity is what? Here oil. So hence water is present in your oil. So thus the continuous phase is what? Oil here, and the dispersed phase is water. It means water, it is getting dispersed into your oil, right? So I have two types of emulsion. First is oil in water and second is water in oil. The commercial, okay, the natural examples of this type of emulsion is, first is your cream, okay, the cream whatever we get, that is the example of oil in water. Water quantity is more here and oil is less. But butter, the butter is what? It is your water in oil example. Oil is the major quantity here, okay, the fats are the major amount, whereas water is getting dispersed into your oil. So that are the natural examples of your oil in water and water in oil type of emulsion.